Moon missions are becoming a bit like buses. It seems as though you wait the best part of 50 years for a return trip to the moon, and then within a matter of weeks, two turn up at once. This is quickly turning into the new space race, but this time it's not between nation states, but between private companies, as Jeff Bezos, the boss of Amazon and space company Blue Origin, has said that they are looking to set up a base on the moon by the mid-2020s. This comes within a week or so after Elon Musk revealed SpaceX's plans to send a couple of paying space tourists on a trip around the moon and back again in 2018 on the as-yet untested Falcon 9 heavy rocket and Dragon 2 crew capsule. As if that wasn't enough, we're now also hearing that the Trump administration is upping the ante by looking at getting NASA returning to the moon sooner rather than later, in an attempt to possibly rerun Kennedy's pledge to put a man on the moon again within Trump's first term. This time, it's not the Soviets he's trying to keep in check, but the other great communist regime, China, who also have their eyes set on the moon. Although NASA will be providing the technical expertise, there is the possibility that they won't be using NASA-built rockets, but instead hardware built, paid for and supplied by private companies like Blue Origin and SpaceX. As is Trump's mantra of avoiding big government, there have also been rumours that NASA's SLS or Space Launch System and the Orion capsule, the remnants of the now defunct Constellation project, could be axed. Though that would be difficult as it could be said to be too big to fail after over 10 years of development and in excess of $10 billion already invested. And this would also upset the big NASA contractors, as well as the Republican senators which support them. The thing is, it would be much cheaper to use private space companies. Dropping the SLS would save over $3 billion a year in running costs, and that would easily finance private space with many more missions for the money. Though what is more likely is that NASA will be urged to speed up its existing plans and look to add men to the upcoming EM1 mission to orbit the moon in a similar way to Apollo 8 in 1968. This would play well with the Trump administration in its first term and send a signal to the various nation-state competitors that the US was once again serious about space and the moon. For now, the Blue Origin plan would be to work alongside NASA to deliver cargo and supplies using a modified version of a vertical landing New Shepard rocket, which could be launched using Blue Origin's New Glenn heavy rocket, which is currently under development. The lander would land on the moon near the Shackleton crater at the South Pole, because there is permanent sunlight for solar power on the high points of the crater, and in its depths there is permanent shade, where there is believed to be water ice, which could be used by manned crews and also create hydrogen and oxygen for rocket fuel. Robotic arms would be used to build lunar habitats and deploy rovers, but not men. Lockheed Martin, Boeing and United Launch Alliance have all been working on concepts for manned lunar space stations, which would act as possible waypoints for any future Mars missions and also control centers for robotic operations on the lunar surface. Then there is the ongoing Mars versus Moon debate. The Trump administration has just signed a bill to add Mars exploration to NASA's remit, so we may have another race between NASA and Elon Musk's SpaceX to the Red Planet. Whether they will join forces like the planned missions to Mars is still uncertain, but it would make much more sense economically than having two separate missions racing to Mars. There is also the EM2 mission, which NASA is working on, which is a manned flyby of a captured asteroid in lunar orbit. Why bother with asteroids, some might say? Well, the reason is that they are seen as the next best step and can offer large amounts of valuable minerals like iron, nickel, gold, platinum and water ice, which again would be used for creating hydrogen and oxygen for rocket fuel. Mining asteroids may be the most profitable choice, but it doesn't carry the cachet set by Apollo. Even if the moon is pretty barren apart from the water ice at the poles, the much touted helium-3 and some platinum group elements from the asteroid impacts. Whichever way things go, it's becoming an exciting time once more for space, and we will see if the will of the private space companies is matched by the political will and the cash from the government to follow it through. And as always, thanks for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.